And we are joined this morning by former Justice Secretary Aguirre. Former Justice Secretary Aguirre, good morning. Welcome back to the program.
Hey, good morning, Attorney Mike, and good morning, Rica.
Let me just...
Yung mga taga-subaybay.
All right, Secretary Aguirre, let me go straight to that new video which you presented to the media yesterday. What was the motivation, Secretary, for bringing it out to the media? And the timing, why yesterday?
Actually, I came to know of that video and that taking of the supplemental affidavit only a few days ago. As a matter of fact, when I came out yesterday, I only was given a copy of the same the day before, nung isang araw lamang. And I was never aware that there was such a video taking on September 23, because the date of the supplemental affidavit was September 26. That video taking was on September 23, or 3 days before the actual swearing in of the affidavit. But you will notice that in this this video was taken before the execution of the affidavit, and so you will notice also that I did not produce it in April when Ragos first retracted his statement. Because you will remember that in April, before the elections, Ragos came out saying that he is retracting statement because I just coerced him into implicating Secretary De Lima in the drug trade inside the Bilibid. Mm-hmm. But when I came to know, I was informed by one of the prosecutors that there was such a video. I requested Chief Percy Acosta for a copy. And pinagbigyan naman niya ako, and we were able to watch that video the other day. And so I got a copy of the same and showed it to those, to the your brothers and sisters in the media.
Mm-hmm. Now, let's talk about SEC, how the PAU was involved in this case. Refresh our minds. Why is the PAU involved in the execution of that affidavit?
You will remember that when the DOJ under me in 2016-2017 was establishing a case against the people involved in the drug trade inside the Bilibid, I was assisted by PAU, by the Public Attorney's Office under Chief Percy Acosta. And when Juvencio Ablen and Ragos came forward with their affidavit implicating Secretary De Lima and Ronnie Dayan in this drug trade, the first to come out with the affidavit is Juvencio Ablen, the assistant of Ragos in the New Bilibid prison. And when Ragos came to know about the affidavit to Ablen, he joined because he was afraid that he might also be charged of an unbailable offense. And so they executed their affidavit in 2016, September 2016. And he sought the protection of PAU if he will be able to be under the PAU's protection. And so he was under the protection of PAU for several months in the office where I think he held office there, although he was formerly an assistant director of the NBI. So that's how PAU came into the picture.
Is that quite normal, Attorney Aguirre, that a government official, an NBI director at that, would seek shelter at PAU out of fear that he might also be charged? He was eventually charged, right? But at this time, during the execution, was he under custody? Was he still not part of the case?
No, he was not under custody. As a matter of fact, he voluntarily sought the protection and the help of PAU. As a matter of fact, he was given allowance by PAU, and PAU told me that he was always requesting for money while he was under PAU custody at that time. It's not custody really, but he was under the protection of PAU. PAU is under the is an agency under the supervision of the Department of Justice. And so I sought the help of PAU because I need many lawyers then in order to develop this case against these people inside the New Bilibid prison.
It's interesting you pointed that out, Attorney Aguirre, because yesterday during the interview with the media, you said you were surprised that there was this video that was taken and that the testimony, in fact, was done in the office of PAO. So are you saying now that you knew at that time that, in fact, he was seeking protection under PAO? So how would you reconcile both statements?
I did not say that I knew this. I know that he is under PAO, but I did not know that in the taking of his, in giving of his supplemental affidavit, that there was a video taken.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was surprised about this video. That was, I came to know of that only a few days ago. Mm-hmm. And so I asked Chief Percy Acosta to give me a copy, and good enough, she was good enough to give me the other day. And mm-hmm. I was able to get some portions of it and distribute to your brothers and sisters in the media yesterday.
Mm-hmm. Now, the lawyer Vragos is saying that the video is not inconsistent with his statements in his affidavit and in court. Now, he challenged the prosecution to show a written waiver of his Miranda rights before a competent and independent counsel. He's saying that this video has no value at all. What do you make of that? How important is this video?
That counsel does not know about this Miranda doctrine.
Mm-hmm.
Miranda doctrine is only when you are under interrogation and police interrogation.
Mm-hmm.
This is not under any police interrogation because he know that he is in partnership with PAO. That's why there is no such thing as the assistance of counsel. Ragos could get his counsel at any time, mm-hmm. but it is not required under the law. And then he said that it has no value kasi daw Ragos has no lawyers assisting him.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, Ragos sought the assistance of PAO in this case against Secretary De Lima. So there is no, this is no longer the assistance or the provision of giving him a lawyer is no longer necessary. And then said that we could not accept this affidavit because this video, because he was not assisted by counsel. That is not correct. As a matter of fact, what I'm trying to prove this is that I never coerced Ragos, and that when Ragos gave his affidavit, including the supplemental affidavit, where a video was taken, he was spontaneous, it was voluntarily and freely given. And hindi lang yun, makikita mo, when you will review for more than 1 hour, he was the one talking, he was the one giving all this information. And as a matter of fact, if you watch the video, you will see so many information that is not in any way related to the 10 million, that's the very issue against Secretary De Lima, to the 2.5 million deliveries. Meron dong sinasabi siya na nag-away si Secretary De Lima and Ronnie Dayan, and Ronnie Dayan poke a gun against the De Lima. Sinasabi rin niya yung other money-making schemes inside the Bilibid, katulad ng tilapia, yung palang tilapia ang ibig sabihin nun, yung pagdadala ng mga babae doon, yung sa drugs, sa citron drugs, nagbebenta sila ng sigarilyo, and the concert Kulamco, ang alam natin na, and this is admitted, na nag-co-concert siya sa loob ng Bilibid. And ang sabi dyan, yung isang trailer ng beer, ubus yun. And you know how much one bottle of beer is cost inside the New Bilibid. Actions of Ragos in volunteering information that he alone knows about, this shows voluntariness. But why are you going to supply information or volunteer information? That is not necessary if you are coerced.
Mm-hmm.
You need to say that it's free.
Attorney Aguirre, for the record, the video that you provided us is only an excerpt of the entire one-hour broad video that you're talking about. We're still asking for the entire video from you. Secretary, why release it to the media a day before Ragos was set to continue? He is going to testify today at the Muntinlupa Court. Are you hoping that this will be used in cross-examining Ragos's recantation?
I am not hoping anything. But if I am one of the prosecutors, I'm going to use definitely this this video in impeaching Ragos, because that's very damaging against his declaration that I coerced him. But why only now? Why? Because Ragos testified. You know very well that before the election, he testified in April. That is, in my opinion, that is to influence the outcome of the election. They failed about it. You must remember that at that time, De Lima was a candidate for senator. That was April 2022. And then I was complaining then, but kako si Ragos, ba't siya magko-complain ngayon? Bakit dito sa media? Why not in court? So when he was not successful, when they were not successful in the election, to influence the election, nandun pumunta siya sa court. That was only October 28. I have to again, peep, my friends were calling me, oh, inaakusahan ka naman ni Ragos, you had to, I was silent because I thought that I was that I answered this already. So when my friends are calling me, baka paniwalaan yan, you must do something. So okay. Nag-research ulit ako if there are any new evidence, and true enough, somebody from the prosecution told me that there was a video taken by the PAO. And so I asked Bercida Acosta to give me a copy, and she was kind enough to give me a copy one day before yesterday.
So, and you're saying
This is not time because Ragos is to testify this morning. But I'm glad that I was able to come out before he testifies this morning.
So you're saying that the information that there is this video actually came from the prosecution, and so they are in possession of this particular video, and it might be used against Ragos today.
That's right.
But
I was never informed that there was such a video.
Secretary Aguirre, your criticism of Ragos going to the media and not presenting it court, that could also apply to you now, because you're talking to the media, you presented in the media. Do you have any plans of presenting this video in court?
I could not intervene because I am not authorized. Only public prosecutors could intervene in this case against De Lima. But if I'll be called to testify, I will. If I have had asked to be a private prosecutor, but that could not be done because there is no damage to any private prosecution. This is damage to the government. That's why private prosecutors could not be allowed to intervene in this case.
Have you had any discussions with the prosecutors, or perhaps with Prosecutor General Benedicto Malcontento, if they will utilize you as a witness to rebut the recantation of Mr. Ragos?
No, I did not discuss with anybody if they are going to subpoena me and be a witness in this case. But if I will be called, if I will be subpoenaed, I will.
Let me go to your meeting with Justice Secretary Remulla yesterday. You said you did bring up this issue that Ragos's discharge as accused from the case is still subject to the approval of the Justice Secretary. Did he say anything about it?
None. No. As a matter of fact, I don't know, because he was very new as a secretary. I don't know if he was ever aware of the department order I issued that all dismissals and drugs cases should be, there is an automatic review by the DOJ secretary.
And there are, of course, some observations online regarding your statement, Mr. Secretary. They're saying, are you in fact threatening Mr. Ragos that he will be charged if he continues with his recantation?
No, actually, because that should be the cause. If ever the decision of the prosecutor to drop him from the case should be done. In other words, because he was not true to his word, I believe that nobody, he could not blame anybody if ever anybody, any justice secretary would act that he be charged of this drug trading inside. I believe it just like De Lima and Diane.
Secretary Aguirre, if not coercion, the Lima camp was saying at least a few months ago that Ragos' testimony was motivated by rewards. Supposedly, he was rewarded for every affidavit that he would execute. For instance, naming the particular caller who supposedly instructed him to deliver money to the Dilimas residents in Parañaque. That supposedly came after he was discharged as accused in the case. And then he was later on reinstated at the NBI. So they're saying that he was actually motivated by the rewards that were given to him in exchange for testifying against Dilima. What do you make of that?
Well, as far as you know, and that's not true, there's mm-hmm. no reward for anybody. There is no reward for any witnesses against Dilima. All of them voluntarily came out, especially when they testified before the House of Representatives. Rago said no less than 8 times. That whenever he is presented as a witness, we know you are a lawyer, that he is being under oath, that I'm going to tell the truth, nothing but the truth. So help me God. So when you execute, or when you say that you are under oath and you execute an affidavit, you are calling on God to witness on the truth of what you said. Ragos failed to do it for at least 8 times. He testified 2 times in the House of Representatives. He testified 4 times in the RTC. We must remember that when he testified in the RTC, it was already in 2019, October 2019. I resigned from the DOJ on April 5, 2018. More than 1 year. Wala na ako sa gobyerno. More than 1 year. I'm just a plain citizen. I was not given any post after I resigned. On that time, when he testified before the RTC of Muntinlupa, wala ako sa gobyerno. So, paano niya ako? How could he charge me of coercion when he was a veteran, the assistant director, a veteran MBI investigator, veteran director for intelligence? How could one believe? Alam naman natin na this retraction, sabi ng Supreme Court, that retractions are unreliable unless backed up by incontrovertible evidence. Libu-libong kaso na ang sinabi ng Supreme Court dyan na hindi kailangan walang weight, actually no weight should be given to a retraction without any incontrovertible evidence. Just like Ragos. Anong sinasabi ng Ragos? Di ba yung sinasabi lang niya na ako ay tinakot ko raw siya? And when I was told that when he was asked during cross-examination in Muntinlupa, he said that, sabi ko raw, alam mo na ang mangyayari sa'yo pag hindi ka titistigo lawang kay Dilima.
Did you say that?
Yun daw ang sinabi ko. I never...
Supposedly, you mentioned that Secretary Aguirre in a meeting in Soler in 2016. Do you recall having that meeting with Mr. Ragos in Soler?
Yes,
you had that meeting?
I never told him that. Actually, Ragos...
But did you meet him in Soler in 2016?
Yes.
You did? Because in your previous interview with us, you can't seem to recall that meeting outside of your office in the DOJ.
Well, I have been out of the government for more than 5 years, and so...
But surely this is a big case, Mr. Secretary. This is Ragos. This is a personality, and presumably you would recall every time you meet with Mr. Ragos, given his stature.
Actually, sinabi niya, nag-meet kami sa pancake.
Oh, that's another allegation. Did you actually also meet him in Pancake House?
No, I don't think
so.
That.
Not in Pancake House, but in Soler. Yes, you did.
Yes.
All right. Now, Mr. Secretary, what do you make of the fact that supporters of Senator Dilima are saying or accusing you of being the architect of this entire case against Senator Dilima, of orchestrating or getting witnesses to testify against her? How do you respond to those allegations online?
It is my duty as a department secretary, especially at that time when the you believe it or the Bucor was under the supervision of the Department of Justice. It is my duty. It's pure and simple. It's my duty.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I could not be said to be an architect just to pin down an innocent woman. No, mm-hmm. Alam mo, Mr. Attorney Mike, you are a lawyer, Ms. Rica. When did this kubol proliferate dun sa New Bilibid, where you could have a cell with the luxury of a 5-star hotel? It was during the time of Dilima. So how can you build that without the Secretary of Justice knowing it? Kailan nag-proliferate itong si Colomco, where you could hold concert inside the Bilibid?
But Mr. Secretary, the establishment of kubol is quite different from the drug trading supposedly being perpetuated inside Bilibid. Those are quite different allegations. But can you honestly tell us, Mr. Secretary, that after 5 years of former Senator De Lima in jail, that she is not innocent, that she deserves to be detained for all these allegations against her, considering that, as pointed out in court, there were no pieces of drugs presented against her?
Well, this is drug trading. Mm-hmm. It is not necessary that these drugs would be presented as a witness. It's different from drugs possession, from drugs importation, where you will have to produce drugs as an evidence. Pag drug trading, hindi na kinakailangan yan, Attorney Mike.
How can you trade something if you cannot present it in court? I think you're referring to conspiracy, Mr. Secretary.
If you have traded already, nagbilihan na. Okay, so there's drug trading, but it could be it was witnessed by many people. But of course, the drugs have been traded, so how could you use them?
Mm-hmm. So you're saying this refers to past actions, but incidentally,
to the evidence,
the charge is conspiracy.
To the evidence needed in order to prove the allegations in the information. In drug trading, it is not necessary that you produce the drugs. It is only in possession or in importation where you need to produce the drugs. But in drug trading, it is not necessary.
All right, interesting. And lastly, Mr. Secretary, if you were to go back in your time, 2016, 2017, would you have pursued the same charges against former Senator Laila De Lima, knowing what we know now?
Of course. As a matter of fact, what I know now, lalo akong nananalig na totoong nangyari yung accusation niya. When I was the DOJ Secretary, many sympathizers of Secretary De Lima in Europe and in America treated me as a breakfast. Sinasabi sa akin, Secretary, could you not release Secretary De Lima on bail or kaya house arrest na lang? Kasi itong nangyari ngayon was just a campaign of your President Duterte against innocent people. Sabi ko ganyan, you are barking at the wrong tree. The DOJ Secretary has no right, has no power to release on bail accused or to have her detained under house arrest. And did you ever think, kakong ganyan, that why President Duterte has an approval rating at that time of 81% or 82% of the Filipino people? Ibig sabihin yan, the Filipino people approved of what President Duterte was doing at that time.
You don't believe this is President Duterte's vendetta against former Senator De Lima?
I don't think so. Kasi kung matatandaan mo, President Duterte has been accused by Secretary De Lima as early as 2029 or 2008, 2009. That was 6 or 7 years before he was elected president. He was the chairman of the Human Rights Commission. He was the chairman. Pero why is it? And then he has the administration of Pinoy. Bakit hindi niya nakasuhan si President Duterte? It was only when President Duterte was elected president, kaya lang niya kinasuhan ulit si President Duterte. Bakit nung sila'y nasa power, when he was the chairwoman of the Human Rights Commission, bakit hindi niya nakasuhan? Because walang ebidensya eh.
Well, on that note, thank you so much for joining us this morning, former Justice Secretary Vitaliano Aguirre.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you also, Rica. And maraming salamat sa inyong mga taga-subaybay.